high school level, any costs that are taking place and things that are getting cut, those get passed on to our families and our students. It's a direct impact on them. At the middle school level, it's a direct impact on our kids. They're asked to pay for more. They're asked to pay for things they haven't paid for before. At the elementary level, I can tell you it's a direct impact on your classroom, classroom supplies. So if it's at all possible, it's $77,000. I think we need to find a way to not do that, because although we're calling it a building allocation, it is a direct hit on our families and our students and our teachers.
Can I make a suggestion? I think we can double the Chinese tuition and easily cover that.
Regardless of that, I think that we can find a way to either make that much less or not do that at all.
I requested some numbers. Do you have those numbers?
For sure you have the numbers, right?
I did leave.
I requested.
Copy, yeah.
I requested, after reviewing this, the number of allocations for elementary, middle school, high school per student.
And just a reminder, so that as we're talking about it, this is the amount that schools receive per pupil from the general fund. Of course, they have some internal accounts, things like POP money and stuff like that, that would not count in here.
So that has to buy school supplies?
But not every building has that. An elementary building does not have that.
That's true.
Not every building has that.
Yes, well,
it's disingenuous for us to sit here and think it's only $77,000. When your art teacher can't get glue. Sorry, but I'm just saying, you are directly impacting your students. We are directly impacting your students.
Parents buying boxes and boxes of paper because the elementary doesn't have any.
So Michelle doesn't have the answers.
Can we get your numbers?
I'm sorry, so what are you asking for?
I'm looking for what is the cost, and I know you gave us, and I appreciate the information that you gave us on the breakout of elementary schools, middle schools, and high schools as far as the salaries, benefits, supplies, and all of that. But what I'm looking for is how much are we allocating per elementary schools students, middle school students, and high school students for the building allocation?
Okay, so the per capita is what we call it. And currently we are, for an elementary, we are currently at 65. The recommendation would bring that to 59. The
$65?
65 right now.
Dollars per child. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It would go down to 59. And what we've seen is the average of other districts was at 42. Middle school, it's at 68. It would go down to 61. And similarly, they have a 42 average as well, the other districts that we looked at. And then for high school, it would be 90 down to 81. And their average of the districts we looked at is 48.
Tell me something. Which part of that is busing?
None.
Well, because I know that high schools have to pay for busing for, like, say, sporting events and things like that out of their budget, right?
Sporting, this isn't for athletics. This is for general ed. And so it would only be for busing on field trips if they're covering that, depending on what the field trip charge. I don't know how they go about doing that.
So am I incorrect then in understanding, because ever again, this has been a frequent discussion, that buses for athletic events are not paid for at the building level?
That's not what I'm saying.
So that is correct.
There is an allocation, and anything over that allocation, it comes out of the athletic budget.
That's not what I understand.
Don?
When you say you've looked at averages, are this averages in the county? Is this average for our size district?
It's average, it's our size districts.
Okay, then taking this a little bit further on the building allocation, and I know I requested this kind of late in the week last week. Were you able to get the number? Because I wanted to see what the, because we allow our buildings to carry over any unused funds. And because we do accrued accounting, we are constantly accruing that into future budgets. So were you able to get that information for me?
Well, the carryover really ends up being part of fund balance, okay? And so, yes, as of June 30th, our last audit, the elementaries as a whole had $212,000 of carryover funds. The middle schools had $203,000 of carryover funds. The high schools had $159,000 of carryover funds. Now, for the middle school, that does include their athletics. For the high school, it does not. The high schools had about $77,000 in carryover funds for their athletics.
So you didn't mention PANCAL or Pelerin?
That I have, the high schools included PANCAL.
Well, I don't think that that's, that completely skews the numbers because I've seen what gets spent, specifically PANCAL, and it's way out of line with what gets spent to other buildings. So the number 90 is probably not correct, right? Because if you include it all together, it's a whole different animal.
No, 90 is what they get.
90 is what they get if you include PANCAL and the amount of money that they are allowed per student. But PANCAL's expenditures in their budget is very different than the other buildings.
But you're talking two different things. We are talking revenue now, just revenue. You're talking expenditures coming out of the revenue. I'm talking just revenue. $90 per high school student, which includes High School North, High School, and Pelerin, correct?
Add
up all of those students that are in those three buildings, and we multiply it by $90 per student.
But and that's what they get for their building allocation, is that what you're saying?
Yes, right. So like if high school, right. These are not pure numbers, but if high school is 2,000 students, they get 2,000 times 90.
Right.
That's their building allocation. If Pelerin is 250, they get 250 times 90.
Now, does this...
See, this is per student.
From that building allocation, because those students spend part of the day at PANCAL, part of that money goes to PANCAL. PANCAL doesn't have a separate money that they get. They get part of the high school allocated money. So if North or High School has 2,000 students and 500 of them go to PANCAL for half of the day, then whatever formula is used to send PANCAL that money.
There is a formula.
They're not getting $90 per student. They're getting
an
allocation from the high school's fund.
Correct.
So it's disingenuous for us to say the high school's getting a complete $90.
Well,
they're not. Part of that money is going to the PANCAL Center to be allocated the way they want it allocated.
They're getting it based on FTE.
Correct.
Okay, so if the student is at the high school for a 0.5 of the day,
right,
they get 0.5.
Right, but we need to realize that and not think, oh, the high school has 2,000 kids times $90, they're getting that much money. They're not. Part of that money is going to the PANCAL Center based on where the kid spends their day.
Mm-hmm. Is it a formula of the FTE or is it direct ratio? They spend half of their day at PANCAL, half of their building allocation goes to PANCAL. Or is it a formula?
It's a formula. Off the top of my head, they give me the numbers and they go in and they figure out how much time a kid is spending and they say how much is that.
Our pupil accounting goes down to the building level. Mm-hmm. It's not, obviously the state tells us how we account for pupils. That's that 90-10 percentage. And that happens not only at a district level, but by buildings. So there's no mystery around the number of students in any building. The state has a formula, they tell us how to do it.
Okay. I have a question. If I understand that other districts send students to Pelerin, how do we allocate funds for those students? Does that district send us our expected amount of money?
Can I jump in for 1 second? So just to clarify, because this is an equation that is working with High School North, and PANCAL. Pelerin is not on this formula yet, and they need to be. But historically, they were funded differently. It was more like this is the money you need. There's all these processes to make sure that there's nothing that it's really needed, and then that's what we fund. It hasn't been the same. So we're really talking about Panko and the two high schools, not Peller. Peller is separate.
But we have students. We do have students come from Panko.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify.
Alan, we give the schools $90 for each high school student, but the out-of-district students that come in just to use that center, do we charge them the same amount?
We don't charge them. We get a percentage of their, a point whatever of their FTE allowance. We count them as part of our kids. So if they're only there 0.2, we would get 0.2 of our FTE allowance.
From the other district?
No, from the state.
Well, from the state.
Well, yes. Right, yes. Right. And so then they would have the remaining to make up for the 1.0, so they can only claim the 0.8 in that example.
Okay.
So we have $7,500 foundation allowance. We want to only put $59 of that towards any kind of teaching supplies, any kind of paper, anything that the kid needs in order to learn at the elementary level.
Well, I just think these building allocations are a little bit different. I mean, there's some different uses of them. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think this allocation is buying paper or pencils.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It's for supplies, yes. Office supplies, so teaching supplies.
If I look at the outline that you gave us for elementary.
What page is it?
It's for field trips, supplies, any kind of paper, pencils, copies.
Does it cover overtime too?
Everything.
All that stuff.
Does it cover overtime? For the most part, no, because the district pays for that.
Would it include, I'm looking at middle school basic instruction. Page 42 of the packet. If there's supplies, there's textbooks, there's teaching supplies, technology, and office supplies. Is that what that building allocation would cover?
It covers part of that, and then the general fund picks up the difference. So I know you went to middle school. I have, when you were doing that, I was going to elementary. So the elementary is $170 for those three categories.
Okay, let's go back to the elementary.
Per student. Of that, they have discretion over, well, how much? 60, whatever it is. The remainder is other funds that we give them within their budget that they don't have, we cover that. So there is a total for those textbooks, teaching supplies, technology, and office supplies. There is a total of $170 per student available in their budget. When we talk about discretionary, what they get to do is move that money around. They might say, okay, we gave them teaching supplies of $400,000. I want $500,000. They get to say, I will take the amount that was in office supplies, move it to teaching supplies, or I'll move it to textbooks, or I'll move it to technology, whatever they care to use in that particular.
So what it boils down to is we're affecting kids with building cuts. And again, we don't have actual budgets for departments, for buildings, for anything. We've never cut the budget here.
Yeah, you got it right here?
That's not true.
I see where you're looking, but you don't have a clue then how much they have that's discretionary and where they spend it. You're sitting here asking, where do they spend it? What's discretionary? What does it mean? And if we don't have that information, we've never been given it, how can you make decisions and say, yes, it's okay to cut them another 10%?
Are you asking for a list of how each building spends their discretionary
funds? I personally am not, because I'm pretty in tune. But I think that might be helpful for other board members to actually see, what is a discretionary budget, how much is it, where do they spend it?
Well, we do have carryover dollars, and did you say this carryover goes into the fund balance, fund equity,
yes,
at the end of the year?
Mm-hmm.
And then the buildings start off at base zero again?
Well, they do an allocation. What we do is we take the spring count typically times the per capita, and that's their building allocation, but they have access to these funds.
Have access to the carryover funds?
Mm-hmm.
And wasn't the carryover set up so that if a building wanted to save to buy more whatever, something special for more iPads, more whatever, that's what it was for?
They can use it for whatever they want to use
it for. Right. So as a board, we shouldn't be sitting here, not saying you're doing this, thinking, well, they have carryover money, so it's okay to cut their budget. Because that may be something that they were going to do extra for their students, and for us to think that it's not allocated or it's not being saved for something is...
Kind of like if you're saving for a car, you might have carryover in your budget every month, but that's you're saving it for a car, Linda. And they do the same things there.
My concern is we want the proposal is to cut by 10%. Costs are going up, and I don't want a teacher to feel that they have to take out of their own personal funds to get something for a classroom, because there's not the money there. Another teacher having to go out and buy extra play supplies because it's just not there, or a third grade teacher wants the books, more reading, because that's what her class needs, going out and buying these books.
And they probably already are going.
And I know, I have a friend that's a retired teacher, and her husband complained she spent half a paycheck supporting the classroom.
Well, a big part of our issue, too, is our changing demographic for Jack's terms. We have declining socioeconomic status in this district. We just do. And we have so many kids that don't have something to eat before they come into class, and these teachers are providing these kids something to eat before they even start school that day. They don't have pencils or papers or notebooks. They don't have glue. They don't have tape. That whole list of school supplies that, you know, a teacher can send home with a kid, there's gonna be 4 or 5 kids in every single classroom that comes in with nothing because they don't have it, they don't have the ability to get it. You know, we do some wonderful things just by the whole backpack program and stuff, but we can't hit everybody, and that doesn't last all year long. And our teachers are buying and buying and buying, and our parents are buying and buying and buying, and we're having to do it because there's no money at the school level. There's nothing. It's been cut and cut and cut, and real cut everywhere that affects a kid, and our budget is a mess because we allocate toward administration instead of to kids.
And just to mention, and I heard everything you said, everything everyone said, we did do a comparison with some other districts, so to try to see. So
every district doesn't have our same socioeconomic status. In every district, you can fuzzy map the numbers until you're blue in the face and get whatever numbers you want. That doesn't make it.
And on fuzzy math, what we're doing. There's no fuzzy math here. There's no fuzzy math here.
Oh, just the request, without all of that discussion, just the request, if we can, if it's possible, not to make that cut at the building level. It's just.
Karen, you have a comment?
All I wanted to say was, I think that every district in Summit you would never think would be in that situation are now walking down the same path. Some are worse than others, and some have been doing it longer than others. It is our new normal in education across the state. I think that one of the places we should focus a little bit more on is, you know, last year there was a lot of talk about how we all know money was taken. We've seen the numbers, right? We know that money was taken per pupil from each district. And yet you would hear from Lansing, we haven't done that at all. The truth of the matter is they did. We live it, we get it, right? I think one place that we should all maybe turn our attention to and be a little bit more proactive and vocal is, why don't we talk about the amount of K-12 public school funding that's been siphoned off and sent to charter schools? That is a big part of our financial issue. And where you sit on charters is, you know, your personal issue, that's fine. But when you, I mean, if you could sit down and do the math about how much money has been siphoned from K-12 public education, and a lot of these charters are for-profit charters, I don't know about you, but that ought to make, that makes me very angry to make, it should make the rest of us angry too. Because that's one of the big reasons why every district in the state is sitting in this financial abyss that we're in. Throw in the other things we can't control and we can't do anything about. We can yell at each other, we can get angry, we can do whatever we want, but the bottom line still is, funding needs to be changed the way we do it in this state, and we need to look at charters, especially for profits, and say, you know what, you're part of the reason. And I love that the state is making the rules that help us in our demise, and then they're going to come in and take you over because you have not spent properly or you are overspending or whatever. I'm not glossing over any of the other issues. I'm just asking that we all do a real hard look at how that has impacted each and every one of us as parents, educators, employees, board members, whatever. It makes a big difference. I don't really know what the number is, what charters have cost K-12 public education funding, but it's probably an amazingly disgusting amount of money.
Real quick. And those charter schools aren't sitting in front of the public and having these discussions about the use of our money. That is not for us to see. This is hidden. How they allocate, where the money goes to, how much they're paying for things, for their buildings, we don't get to see. We spend that money. But I think we've heard, and I don't think anybody at the table would say, you know, our staff, I think the very good points about these costs continue to rise for teachers, for everybody. The idea of impacting our, and I think it's a good point as far as, you know, the impact of the demographics of what's happening in the classrooms. I think you've heard that this is one of those things that the board is probably looking for further discussion on.
Okay. Next one is restructure counseling staff. We don't actually have or have not previously had any kind of ratio on this. And it's not an uncommon thing. And actually, we had a conversation at the board table on this. Maybe it was a year ago. So what this proposal is doing,
on the phone or the video, I would just keep going and let me change it.
So what is it that you plan on doing to save $150,000?
Yeah, actually, and it was outlined in here, but actually what we're talking about is a 0.5 change at the high school and 0.6 in the middle schools. So 0.5 at the high school level, 0.6, 0.8 is a combination of two middle schools that are in that
room. So you're going to share conservation?
What frequently happens is, so we give an allocation, we do this with teachers as well. So you give an allocation to the building, and then the building is empowered to make their staffing however they want, right? So you give an allocation to a building based on the number of students they have. And so, for example, let's say somebody's going to get an allocation of 2.4.
Person on staff that could handle counseling for a group of children, you allow this?
No, they have to be certified.
You have to be certified, of course.
Assuming, yes.
Assuming that they are certified.
Within the laws and certification.
Yeah, and right now, to answer Mary, none of the middle schools are sharing a counselor currently, nor are there any plans for that for next year.
Does this take a counselor off staff at any particular building?
Does it, it reduces counseling assignments for existing counselors, but it does not eliminate any of the counselors.
Does it mean that there won't be a counselor in a building at all times?
No.
No. No.
Does it reduce the number of counselors in a building at any given time?
Well, if you look at this and you look at our ratio numbers, I think I brought this up before. We have less students at one high school than we do at the other, but we have the same amount of counselors. To me, that doesn't make sense. So if that means that there's going to be half of a counselor, however it's distributed by student ratio, and someone ends up with less counselors than they have right now, then it's by student ratio.
Here's my concern. My concern is that, for instance, our middle schools, very mm-hmm. specifically our middle schools, which I think that we have a little bit of heavy administration sometimes. But I don't want our kids to be in a situation where they're in a middle school, something big happens, and there's nobody there for them, because I don't think that should be the staff. And my concern is because we certainly have one middle school that's much smaller than others, and when you figure out your allocation numbers, my concern is that counselor is not going to be available to kids, especially when you're decreasing your social work too.
Yeah, our smallest middle school has about 500 students, so they maintained a full-time counselor.
And would this ratio maintain that? That's
yes,
my question.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, what about at the elementary schools? Do we have somebody in the building if there's issues?
We have no counselors in elementary schools.
I understand counselors, but we do have social workers in elementary, correct?
Yes.
And you're talking about decreasing social workers.
The social workers aren't there every day.
No. We always share social workers between elementaries,
right.
And some buildings do not have a social worker every single day. However, in the event of an emergency, and we've done this, they just go. So if we have a very serious issue arise, we kind of do a check of who, you know, could come and help at that moment, and we send someone over.
So they can be moved around. In emergency, if say something happened to a child
and
it's devastating the building, that social worker, or perhaps more than one social worker,
correct.
Go to that school.
And we have done that before. In a tragic situation, something's happened to a student or a parent.
I'm not talking about
whatever.
A tragic situation at all.
But currently, we do not have a social worker every single day.
But we're going to let her finish, right? She
yeah.
was in the middle of explaining.
I just want to make sure.
It's me, too.
I'm just.
So currently, we do not have a social worker every single day, all day, in every single elementary. Okay. All right. I thought that was your question. I apologize.
That's elementary.
Okay. Correct. Secondary, at the middle school, there is also social workers.
So my question is...
So if you wouldn't mind, Mary, could you direct it to me?
Why are you interrupting me?
I'm just asking you to direct your question to me. That's all. I'm sorry. I apologize for interrupting. Would you mind directing
okay,
the question?
Okay, so she's answering my question, and I'm clarifying.
Mm-hmm.
Just settle down.
Excuse me.
Shut up.
Chair.
So my question is if a child comes in with an issue that day, there is somebody available. My concern is coverage, plain and simple.
At middle school?
No, at the elementary. That's where social workers are, right?
Social workers are K-12, but yes, at the elementary, if someone came in at that day, we would have a social worker available.
Okay, so that was counseling staff. And I know that this one is a challenging conversation, and so hopefully you noticed in my note to you, reduce Panko transportation, because I am aware of the history of, and the tragic history. But what this proposal is, there's been a change in the law. I'm not exactly sure whether it was within the year. So students who are 16 years old, kids who are 16 years old, can only have one other person in the car with them, which is why we're bringing this, you know, recommendation forward. But there is room in the budget to take it out if that's what we feel we want to do. But this idea would be, excuse me, Panko juniors and seniors would be allowed to drive to Panko. So they would, you know, so obviously a bus would need to be available for the students because, you know, some kids aren't going to have a car. They're not going to have access to a car. So this would be an option that would be available. I think we all know that if given the option, kids would take it if their parents allowed them to, if they had the way to do it. So we do think that it would generate some savings in transportation costs. I am aware of the historical issue here. There's a change in the law, but you know, that's really for the board to discuss.
I have a question. Out of areas, out of district schools that come to Pancap, do they pay them, does that school pay for transportation for their student to come?
Yeah, they get their kids here. It's their responsibility
to get their kids here.
Okay, we would have to keep a bus going, running anyway.
We'd have less buses.
For freshmen, sophomores. So where's the savings coming from? The number of buses?
Or the runs?
The number of buses. So if you currently have two buses running to Panko at the same time, if you currently have two buses, you could change it to one, you know?
Yeah. Doesn't that open the district up to liability?
Yes. If the families were made aware of it, and the families, I mean, it would be a part of an expected sign-off.
Yes.
So there would be parental waivers?
Oh, yes, yes.
So, yes. I don't want to get like deep into the whole, but so if you've got a kid that's driving and their parents say it's okay, and another kid jumps in the car with them, and we have no waiver for that kid, which high school kids would do, and something happens,
we're still
how do we get around that? Mm-hmm. I mean, I just want to make sure if this is something that we decide to do, that we're covering all of our bases, because we can't rely on students to be like, oh, yeah.
Just try to waiver.
I can try to waiver.
We just had the kids up by Richmond on Gratiot that were just killed 5 years ago.
Well, we had a tragedy.
So,
yeah, it's true.
Yeah, but that was an open lunch thing. That one was, the one up on Gratiot was specific to, they were going to CTE programs. I think it was a diesel engine repair or something like that. Mm-hmm. They were going to a CTE program, and they were doing the back and forth, and they're goofing around. They're just being kids. They're just dumb.
Which is something we can't control. The things we can control are fine. I'm interested in looking into how this does save us money, but we can't control the one or two kids that hop in the car with the kid that's allowed to drive and something happens.
You're right.
And we have no control if they're only going to have one in the car. I mean, their kids said, oh, I'm going to school. Can you take me?
Well, but they would then, the difference is now the way the law is, if they're on that new license for age 16 and they make that choice and something does happen, there are legal implications now. Not that you can stop a tragedy from happening, but they are not legally allowed to do that for that preliminary license. Obviously, once they get past that preliminary license and the next step, then they can, but they can't. And that is something that's new in the past several years that used to not be the case. You got your license, you could pile 20 people in the car with you.
Legal implications, though, don't change.
Liability.
Or something.
Liability implications don't change. The legal aspect does, because they know that if they get stopped for, you know, not stopping at a stop sign or something, and they have those other people in the car, and they're not over, you know, they're not adults over 21, and they're not related to them, then they could lose their license. Mm-hmm.
But currently we have two buses running, one from each school.
Eric,
more than two buses.
It's more than two buses.
Yeah.
More.
It's more.
And it's almost every hour.
Yes, because it's every child goes to Panko is
bus.
From our buildings.
I have a question. You have $150,000 put on this. When we looked at not having an MSD program, the savings in busing was only going to be $50,000 to eliminate it completely, and you're saying to eliminate it for two grades. And I looked at the numbers actually just yesterday, and the number of older kids, and I don't know about the CTE program, so I can't really speak to that, but about 160, right, Eric, kids in the MSD program, and of that, probably 80 of them are upper level, So you're talking about 80 kids. How does that save us $150,000?
So I think,
I mean, if we double it for the CTE programs, it's 160 kids. How does it save us $150,000?
Yeah, I do think it's somewhat apples and oranges. So under this, so when we're talking about MST, we were talking about, and I don't remember specifically the line item you're talking about, but when we did our analysis for MST, we were talking about MST coming out of the out of Panko, but we also were talking about that we would fill those classrooms with something else, perhaps CTE. In this scenario, what we're talking about is Panko CTE perform. I'm sorry, CTE MST performing arts. None of the kids that are at Panko that are juniors or seniors. I mean, there's a little wiggle room for kids.
So how many kids are we talking about? Number, because like I said, we're talking about 80 MST students, and let's just double that for CTE. What's our capacity?
Oh, yeah, MST is only a small portion of the building, so it's not
double. That's why I'm asking.
Okay,
how many kids do we have there?
You know, this is what we can do. So we are not, the person who does the actual looking at the routes and how the consolidation of those routes would occur is not sitting at the table. We can get the numbers that make that equation, but that's not here. We don't have that at the table.
Okay, but
we have the experts in the district who are doing it.
150 kids, you're saying that we're going to save $1,000 in transportation. We have 180 school days a year.
I'm confident.
I mean, you're talking about $50 per day per student.
We'll get that for you. We'll get you how this 150 was made up. But we had transportation look at the routes and how they could be consolidated without juniors and seniors. But now when you're asking the specifics about that,
yeah.
I don't have that. But I can get it for you.
Because this seems like a crazy
so
number.
So had you called us with that in advance, because we sent this out a week ago, we'd have it at the table. But you didn't, so I can get it for you.
Well, Jackie, I don't like the answers you come up with.
Okay, let's take a break. We've been going at this for almost 2 hours. And I'm sure people would like to get up. So we'll take a break. 10 minutes. 11 o'clock, okay?
Thank you.